Good afternoon, well, rather good evening. This is the Lisa Baxter Show. I'm glad that you're tuning in because I got a good lineup show for you today. That's right, a very good lineup show for you today. Like I told you, this is the Lisa Baxter Show, giving you the 411 in the kidney world. Well, today I got a beautiful diva that you're going to meet today. Her name is Julie Childs. Julie Childs started this beautiful, great foundation for her brother. I'm going to let her tell you, but I just wanted you to know Julie Childs is a queen, a blessed woman, a businesswoman, and a no-nonsense woman. And she's strong. She's a real kidney warrior. But let me shut up and let me bring her on so she can tell you what she got to say.
Hi, Lisa. Hi, everyone. Hey. This is Julie. Thank you for those accolades. That was very nice, but you are the true warrior. Mm. I'm just, you know, one of those people that do what I can. And firstly, I wanted to let everyone that know that my name is Julie Childs. I don't cook. I cook, but I'm not like Julia. And my brother, Dennis, was diagnosed with kidney disease back in, you know, several years ago, but kept it a secret from us. And in 2012, he needed a transplant. And that's when the siblings, all of us, it's seven of us, plus another brother in Philly. So it was eight of us. We decided to come together, our families, and create the Dennis Wiseman Kidney Foundation to educate ourselves as well as others about this dreadful disease. So,
well, you got a big family. Wait, slow down a minute. You got a big family. I got a big family too. I came from a big family of six. It was 17 of us, but it ended up just being six. So you got a big family as well. So when you say this disease, which disease are you talking about? We want them to know.
This is chronic kidney disease.
Chronic kidney disease,
not polycystic, which is genetic. But Dennis chronic kidney disease is usually caused by, you know, obesity, diabetes, a hypertension, a combination of the two. And Dennis didn't really have either of those. He's always had, his pressure was always high since he was a kid, but he never suffered from diabetes like a lot of the family members on my dad's side suffered from. So Dennis is a former professional football player, former New York Jet, running back. Yes, in the mid-80s. So he was always a family superhero. And he carried himself like that. So he kept it a secret. He knew it was five sisters, two boys. He was one of the two boys and my other brother in Philly.
Okay.
So we were always, you know, how women are. We would get upset, nervous about things. So he didn't tell us for 10 years until he actually needed the transplant. He was misdiagnosed with lupus and different things. And then he was treated with chemotherapy. It was a lot. And then they found out after they, you know, exhausted all other angles, they decided to send him to Alonzo Mourning specialist. Alonzo Mourning is former basketball player who suffered from sclerosis. Okay. So that's when they discovered Alonzo's same physician diagnosed Dennis, and he knew right away that he said, this is focal sclerosis. They had to take, you know, a biopsy, and it was confirmed he had focal sclerosis, which is a genetic disorder as well, but they don't know where it comes from.
Okay. And now, Julie, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. Now, Dennis was supposed to come on today with you. At least you invited him to come on, right? And today is his birthday, so we give him a shout out. Happy birthday, Dennis.
Yes. Happy birthday, Dennis.
Enjoy yourself, you know. So I didn't want to forget to do that. But you said because he had this issue, this is why you start the foundation, because I want to know why you started it, you know. Mm-hmm. And then I want to know some stuff about you, too. So we're going to get into that. So you started it when you found out he was ill. And you started it. How did you start it?
We collectively started it. The family started.
Okay, the siblings.
The siblings. We got together and we didn't know if to call it a foundation,
association,
one of those things. Different ideas was tossed up in the air, and mm-hmm. we thought it was best to create the foundation. We had no idea it was going to be so much work in terms of filing the 501c3 mm-hmm. and things of that nature. But so we got started. It was a lot of work, but it was filed. My good friend Ruth Smith, she actually did the paperwork. And it passed the first time. Usually you have to go through this like two or three times before the city mm-hmm. gives you the okay or the federal government. But she had filed one before, so she had experience. She did it one time, came back, it was approved. And mm-hmm. so we are a 501c3 tax exempt organization. And we do things such as health fairs. We have a 5K walk every year.
Yeah.
And we also have a huge gala that takes place on Long Island.
The gala is excellent. I've been there. Yeah. You gave me a leadership award there. It was like the stars came out. I mean, the red carpet, a beautiful hotel, great food and everything. You even sent a car to get me. I said, get out of here. You didn't want me taking no transportation. You wanted me to be in style. So I appreciated that.
Absolutely.
I appreciated that. I know your foundation do good things for people. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm glad you started it. But a lot of people don't know anything about, the foundation and what have you. So tell them what your Facebook page is or your website. So somebody that might want to start a foundation or want to get in touch with you in any mm-hmm. way or even donate to you or whatever they want to do, be a volunteer, say what it is.
Yes, the Dennis Blidget Kidney Foundation, our website is www.dennisblidgetkidneyfoundation.org. And our website is facebook.com/DB Foundation. D as in Dennis, B as in Elijah Foundation. So you can find us there and you see photos and videos of the gala, of the walks, of the health fairs. And we partner with Mount Sinai Mount Sinai is there, a kidney transplant team. Dr. Sandra Florman and his team, they do a fabulous job. And Dennis's donor, I wanted to mention too, Jill Christensen. Hey, shout out to Jill.
Excellent.
You might be.
Yeah, Jill.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, them donors, they're heroes, I had to thank my family for the family that gave me my kidney, I understand. Thanks again, Jill.
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful thing. Plus, we also partner with the National Kidney Registry. And that's how I came to find Lisa Baxter.
Right.
Joe Sinecor.
Good old Joe. I'm trying to get him on the show. Yes.
He's a great guy. And he's emceed our program a couple of years. And he's just a fabulous individual. So he introduced us to the Lisa Baxter show that was on YouTube. And, mm-hmm. Lisa does not let any grass grow under her feet. She's very humble. She's, gregarious personality, but very informative, very loving, very giving. And you really deserve that leadership award. She really did. And she could have spoke a little longer, but I think I frightened everybody into talking for 2 seconds at the gala.
I tried to stay under my time a minute, but you also are a warrior yourself. You have a dialysis journey. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes. Well, I was diagnosed with hypertension in my late 30s, and a diabetes went in my, I guess, early to mid 40s. Uh-huh. And it was controlled sometimes, uncontrolled a lot of times. Mm-hmm. And I had one doctor that I went through for about 20 years. And then I retired from my Manhattan, my position in Manhattan, because all my doctors were in Manhattan. I worked there, and so it was more convenient. So
Yes.
I ended up transferring to a doctor in Queens in Forest Hills, and he did a physical and saw that, my kidney function numbers were a little off and sent me to a nephrologist. And she had me tested twice. And told me that I was going to need a kidney transplant myself in about 2 years because my kidney function was, decreasing so rapidly.
Wow.
So it was anyone who's diagnosed with that is like cancer, I guess. It's like an out-of-body experience. I was physically sitting in a chair, but I felt like I was outside my body looking at myself in the chair, like, this is a dream. I'm going to wake up. This is not happening.
Well, it can feel like a nightmare. You gotta
Right.
make it a dream for yourself because you gotta take care of yourself, go to your treatments and
Exactly.
everything. You gotta do what you gotta do, to make it a wonderful thing or a pleasant thing for you while you're going through it. So I
Right.
understand a nightmare, but
But
let's take
to
it
be honest with you, Lisa, and I want everyone to know, everyone doesn't always have to go on dialysis before their transplant because I haven't gone on dialysis yet. I work every day, work pretty hard. I'm an insurance sales woman and I work pretty hard. I have a little team and I'm managing, and it takes a lot of time. Plus, I work director of the foundation and I also do church work, women supervisor of my local church. So it's a lot of hats. Plus, I'm a wife and mother of two adult daughters. So
I
it's a
ain't
lot
mad
of,
at you.
yeah, a lot of
Yeah.
juggling. But when I was
Yeah.
diagnosed and when she told me that, I really was, kind of taken aback. I knew I wasn't taking care of myself quite like I was supposed to, but I didn't know the function was that bad. I never was told that by my other doctor. So I, didn't talk about it for a couple of days. Then I mentioned it to my husband, and he immediately just decided, he said, well, I'm going to be your donor. So
You
I
sound like my
told him,
husband did.
yeah, very nice. So he went to be tested, and everything turned out fine. He was a match. It was a grueling process, as you know, all the blood, the exams, a full day.
Full.
So a week later, the nephrologist called him and said, everything looks good, but there was something in your bladder that you need to see a urologist about just to make sure everything is okay. So he
Yes.
goes to the urologist, and the urologist tells him, it looks like you have some tumors on your bladder. They had to test it. Sure enough, it was cancer, but it was stage one bladder cancer.
Okay. Oh.
So as they say, glory be to God, it was stage one, not stage two, three, or four. No symptoms, asymptomatic.
Yes.
And bladder cancer is very,
Thank
very
God.
serious. You usually
Yeah.
die when you find out about it. You're at stage three or four. So he was treated for it, had surgery, had them removed, had 6 weeks of immunotherapy treatment.
Wow.
And by the grace of God, he went back, they checked. And he's all cleared, just a little scar tissue left. But because of that, he couldn't be my donor. And so next up on the plate was my oldest daughter, Shauna, who wanted to be my donor. But all
Look
of a
at that, the
sudden,
family stepping up. I like that. She
I
stepped
was,
right in.
yes, and she was only 28 at the time. She's 29 now. But she developed these fibroids, unbeknownst to her. She just had excessive bleeding and very bad bleeding, so much so that she was recently hospitalized, and she's doing okay. But God is good. So she couldn't be the donor. And in the meantime, this young lady who we met before, she's come to a few of our galas. She's a very, very good friend of Dennis's donor, Jill. 50 years old. She's walked with us. She walked with us last year for the first time. She did the kitty walk, and that's when she discovered I need a transplant. You know, we walked, talked, I laughed and talked with other people, but unbeknownst to me, she started thinking about being a donor. And so, you know, she had lunch. We had lunch. We talked. First, she went to Mount Sinai. Yeah, she went to Mount Sinai. Then we had lunch and we talked about it. And she stepped forward to be my donor. And
look at that. Look at that.
Yes.
You never know who's watching you.
You never know
who's got your back. You don't. Sometimes it's a stranger. I know a stranger gave me a kidney. It was a stranger. A son gave me his mom's kidney. So, you know, you never know. And look at that. She had lunch with you. She went to Mount Sinai. She felt like being a donor. She didn't even want you to go through anything.
That's beautiful. It was wonderful. So she, her name is Margaret Cardinal. And hopefully you're watching. She just got back from Hawaii. But Aloha.
Yeah, right? The grass skirt, you know.
Yes. She and another friend of theirs, which is Christine. So she was a match. She was a match. And so we are scheduled to have surgery in a couple weeks on Thursday, March 14th, 2019. So
That is fantastic. That's your good news.
Yes,
this is why I interviewed you today, because you might not feel like being bothered or nothing in your face when you come trying to heal from your transplant.
Exactly.
You're going to be too busy happy about it and healing at the same time.
Yes.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Very
kudos to Margaret.
Thank you, Margaret. Thank you, Jill. Thank you, DBKF. Thank you, my siblings, my parents, everyone, to Lisa for this program. I just, you know, God has been good. And another thing I wanted to say, I call Jill as well as Margaret. They are my sisters from another mister.
That's all right. I ain't mad at you.
They are really like my blood sisters, you know, because so many of my blood sisters would love to have done this. But, you know, like most families, they have similar diseases, hypertension, diabetes, borderline.
Yeah, mine couldn't give me a kidney either. I couldn't give them one. They couldn't give me one. But the love was there. The love was there, you know.
Right. Thank Margaret. You know,
thank goodness for her. Now, what was one of the best things you think came out of your experience? If there's a best thing that could have came out of your experience, what is the best thing that came out of your experience, whether it be from what you was dealing with or your family dealing with or even your foundation? What was the best thing or the proudest thing you could have been about with this thing?
Well, the proudest thing, you know, when we came up with the idea of the foundation and giving information to other people, little did I know that I would need, you know, a kidney 7 years later down the road.
Right.
So that was the pearl, you know.
Yeah.
That was the pearl at the end of the day, because I really, really, you know, worked very hard with the foundation along with the team. Also, shout out to my girl, Denise Mason, who's my partner in the foundation work, and Leon, who's the executive director, and also Dennis.
Yeah.
And Dennis has a great mind and great ideas. Also to my other siblings, Lisa, Lori, Shauna. My daughters who help out when they can, especially in terms of Facebook. But I really think it was a level of humility. You just like, wow, this is real.
Yeah, you have to learn something from this experience, and you got to take something from it as well. So each journey, the 12 years of dialysis on me, you know, I learned how to be consistent and do what I had to do. I could do anything because I made it to my treatment. I took care of myself. So I wasn't sick with no other things, basically. And with the transplant, you also got to be on your game, you know, with it. Do what you got to do.
Medicine. You got to take that medication.
Otherwise, take the medication, you better watch all those infections out there, outside, or where you going. You know, when you got to wear the mask, wear it. You know,
I'm
not supposed to eat, you know, the buffet stuff. Don't eat it. You could be starving. Don't eat it. You know, You got to really pay attention to the rules and pay attention to this, because this is very serious what we deal with. Enough people don't know about what we deal with. And what I'm glad about is Steve that brought me on to let me do the Lisa Baxter Show on this. I'm very happy to him and Tamika and all the other the Crushed Kidneys. I mean, all the other shows that's on there are phenomenal. You know what I mean? Sisters with the Kidney Disease, the Coffee Talk. All of that, you know, it couldn't be enough awareness enough. And I just hope it get out there where people will know that we do care and we are trying. And too bad we don't have a real commercial out there, because we need it. We should have it. But if we have to start this way, we're going to start somewhere and we're going to get it done. That's all to it.
I know, Lisa, you'll get it done.
Well, my bishop says it takes teamwork to make the dream work. So, you know, it takes us all. A lot of us got foundations and stuff going on, but we can come together as a family and make stuff happen, too. Not just individually or apart, but together we can be dynamite.
Absolutely. We can be
dynamite, you know? You know, I'm laughing because I looked and I put my clock way over there where I can't see it. Knowing pretty well, I got 30 minutes. I don't want to go over. But this is some juicy stuff. And I really just hope everybody out there learns something, you know? I always say, take care of your kidneys and they'll take care of you.
Take care of you. But you know what I want to ask you, Lisa? Can you elaborate more about the lifestyle after the transplant? Dennis told me about it, you know, certain things you just can't no longer do, certain foods and places you just, just longer makes sense.
They accused me of still acting like I was on dialysis because I was still measuring water. Look, I did that for 12 years. It's hard to break the habit. You know, certain things I was still doing, you know, and then I remember the day I had to go, and then I noticed I don't got to go anymore. So, but it was I missed the sandwich meat that they used to cut because of the germs and stuff while they slicing the meat. Yeah. You can't have it. And I would be killing for one of those roast beef sandwiches or those, what you call it. But I know, you know, how it is. And everywhere you go, I would actually tell the people, listen, I'm on dial. So I'm in a restaurant. I tell them that I got a transplant. This got to be well done. Or I just be honest. And they really care when you tell them that. They'll say, we didn't know. And then when they see you all the time, they already know what to do. But your medicine is very important. And the good thing about that is they're on speed dial, the hospital or the 24-hour thing. So if you make a mistake or miss a dose or something, they go through all of this with you. But stuff happens when you're no longer in the hospital, and the team will follow you for a minute. But once the team finish with you, God help us all. You better know your stuff. I'm telling you. They used to treat me so nice, and now they still nice to me, but they different now because I guess I'm supposed to be more mature in it. So it's like, all right, hi, Lisa. You know, it's over. The love was over already. But, you know, hey.
You know what to do.
Yeah, you know what to do. Yeah, so it'll be all right. You're gonna love that different journey. But the good thing is you never experienced dialysis. But if you're feeling any illnesses or sicknesses now, the transplant should make some of those things better or disappear, as your doctor might have told you, you know, or help you better with it, you know?
The joint pain, right.
Don't talk about joint pain. Don't go there with them joints now. The little sneaky things, you know what I mean? Some sneaky things, you know, but... But I'm telling you, I'm glad that you care enough to look at somebody and award them, me or anybody. And listen, no award is worth it if nobody learned anything from me, my life, my testimony, or this show. That's what makes it count. You know what I mean? Because everything out there got a foundation and stuff, and all the other illnesses got big time play on TV. Exactly. But we take what we can get. But I'm telling you, if I have to prophesy about it, that one day or so, they're going to have to give us a commercial about dialysis and transplants and stuff. I mean, a real one, no little 2-minute thing, a real solid thing. Because I love the way they did something with diabetes, and you see the person's foot cut off or the cancer, with person smoked and they really die. I mean, what about dialysis? We go through hell every day. You know what I mean? Low blood pressure, big giant needles in your arm, hurting one in, one out, seeing your blood going all the way around in the machine. That's a trip. Then getting nauseous and dizzy, throwing up, passing out, falling out, figuring out where you at, thought you died. Don't get me started. You know, that's a whole nother show. Lord have mercy, that's a whole nother show, you know.
Yeah,
this is crazy, you know. But
I'm fortunate I didn't have to go through it. I had, you know, the beginning stages. I was feeling nauseous and I would throw up. And even now, if I eat greasy food, you know, I will throw up. But
that grease will mess with you. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't need it anyway. So every now and then I get crazy, and the next thing I know, I'm sick. I'm like, what were you thinking?
Right. Yeah, not that 5 minutes of fame of enjoying it, and next thing you know, your eyes fall. You know, and I've been there, done that. You know, I usually behave myself, but you know, I may not drink and smoke, but I will want something good to eat that I feel like eating. But I know how to do things in moderation, and in certain times, you know, and sometimes it's just no, you can't have it, you know. So I can live with that. But is there anything that you would want to say to anything or anybody? In reference to, you know, anything to anybody to help them with the journey of going into a transplant or you getting a Dodge dialysis or anything like that?
Yes, all praise. First of all, I'm just realizing I'm at 5% on my phone, so I apologize. But I give it up to God. God, because at one time I was a little nervous and even anxious, like, and I prayed about it and read
prayer words, was good,
you know, and I believe all is well. It's all is well, and I have a peace now, so I'm looking forward to the surgery.
I love peace. There ain't nothing like peace,
right? And turning page, starting a new chapter in my life. So, but I do want to let everyone know also that we have. Our annual gala is September 18th.
On all right, put it out there.
Yes, September 18th at Cristallo Country Club at 6:30 p.m. And, you know, go on the website for more information. It's not out there yet, but you'll be seeing a save the date and things like that. Also, our 5K walk is usually in the last week of April. But because of my situation, we're going to push it up to, I believe, the first Saturday in June, but that's not confirmed. But that's what we are looking at, the first week in June. Not sure if it's going to be in Manhattan or Long Island this year. But we have one every single year. All right. I don't know if we're having a health fair, but if we are, it'll be later on. But September 18th. Dennis Blige and Kidney Foundation, Crest Hollow Country Club.
Well, it sounds like a plan.
Yeah, and I will be honoring one of the, we know, will be God Be My Helper if I'm still with us.
Okay.
My daughter.
Well, I'm looking to also have Yesenia and Christine on the show, and I met them through you.
Oh, okay.
So I'm, you know, we're trying to get a little bit of everybody on here, you know, different, you know, feelings, different thoughts and, you know, stuff like that. The way how a dialysis patient feel one way, a transplant patient feel another way, but we all got a lot in common. And sometimes the family feel a different way or go through something different. The doctor thinks something different about us. So we putting it out there. So I'm trying to bring in help for us as well. So different foundations that will give car fare, money, referrals and help. So I'm using my social work skill as well. So we're just going to use it all and we're going to share it and we're going to be here for each other. So what time do you got? Since we're a team, I'm glad we're a team. Since I'm not in front of my my thing, my clock is over there. I still can't read it sideways. What time do we got, sister?
I don't know on my watch.
Oh, you don't know either? Okay.
Is that all?
Well, I'm sure about now it should be 30 minutes or so. But I will say that... that it was a pleasure to have you on. And it's a pleasure to know that you're going to get this transplant. I know that you need it. I know that you desire it. Believe it or not, we have a new show on this network that deals with transplant. So they have the person put their blood work up and you know, the hospital they go to and all that. I thought that was phenomenal. You don't have to really beg so much for you know, because people get scared, they get nervous, they run from you, you try to get a kidney or any kind of organ. But with that being up, the person have a chance to think about it and actually do it or find out what it means. Some people look at a kidney, what? I don't got nothing to give, you know.
But my husband just said it's 8:37.
Is it now? Okay. Beautiful. Thank you, Mr. Giles. Thank you very much. So we're going to say good night, and we're going to say thanks for tuning in and looking in and sharing. I hope you learned something, because we always want you to learn something, give you a little tidbit or something just for you. Okay? So be well, be blessed, get some sleep, do what you got to do, transplant people, and do what you got to do, dialysis people, and organizations and associations, let's work together. You heard it on the Lisa Baxter Show. Good well, good night, the girl with the 411 on kidney matters, kidney issues, kidney disease, kidneys. Good night.